So I will talk about industrial urgency, this is my plan. At the first moment, I will talk about the industry and the place of industry today, which seems to be really a little bit more, a little bit better recognized. Then I will talk a bit about the reasons of industrial decline. I will talk mainly about France, but I think this poor dynamic is in most countries to be seen. And then I will talk about the components of an industrial contract. I think we need an industrial contract at the heart of a new development model. So these are the three points. And as Danny said, I will try to stay in 30 minutes, so we have the time to discuss afterwards. So at the first point, the place of the industry. The place of the industry is a little bit more considered today. Till the last years, the last decade, I would say, this place was considered as marginal. I think it's very important. And you have, of course, in mind the work of Colin Clark. It tells you something, Colin Clark. It's an economist, no? And Colin Clark is the one who has developed the idea that a modern country has to have a strong service sector. And it's not so important to have industry. And in the long run, the idea of Colin Clark is to say, when a country develops, then is the main sector agriculture. And then afterwards, the secondary sector, it means the industry, takes the relay of the agriculture. And if this economy still develops, then the services are supposed to take the place of the industry. So the idea of Colin Clark, which is really very diffused, is that a modern economy is a service economy, and the place of industry and agriculture has to decline. So I think this view, this perspective, is very diffuse but completely wrong. What we may see is that today, and I think it's true since a long time, there is no single country which is developed without any industrial basis. I think this is very important. And even for developing countries, if you consider them, then you will see that they do develop, or at least they are growing with a strong dynamic in the industrial sector. Okay, and last year, as I was here, there was a very interesting discussion about Greece. My assumption was last year, you remember this discussion perhaps, Danny, that the problem of Greece is not so much public expenses or deficit. The problem of Greece, the main problem of Greece, is too weak industrial sector, and even too weak agricultural sector. And starting from this underdeveloped industrial basis, then of course Greece has to import to cover the consumption. And from there, there are a lot of problems, of course. For example, comment dire, le chômage, unemployment and public deficits and so on. But perhaps we'll have this discussion afterwards. I would like here to stress that if you consider the employment, and this indicator is not the best indicator for industry, in my opinion, then you will see that direct and indirect industrial jobs, I mean with indirect jobs linked to services having a strong relation to industry, then if you consider direct and indirect industrial jobs, they together represent 45% of the total employment in the market sector. So it is impossible to say that this sector, industrial sector plus services related, is a marginal sector. It's completely wrong. And if you consider then exportations or even R&D expenditure, then you will see that the industrial sector represents 80% or 85%. But if we see the industrial dynamics for the last 20 years or 30 years, in almost all European countries, and this is also true for America, North America, the industrial basis has been very strongly reduced. There is one country making a strong exception in Europe, is Germany. The place of industry in Germany still increases since 20 years, even 30 years. And this is really an exception. Perhaps in the discussion we'll try to discuss why this exception is so important. The competitiveness, this is a diagnostic the competitiveness of the industry in the most European countries has deteriorated, and this generates today macroeconomic and social problems. The first problem is the foreign trade deficit. I have calculated that if France, for example, would have no foreign trade deficit in the industry, it would bring between 2 points and 3 points more by the gross domestic product. And this is a very, very strong difference. If we would have balance in the foreign trade according to industry, it will signify that the gross domestic product will be much more dynamic than it is. With this very low dynamic, macroeconomic dynamic, we have, of course, unemployment. We have lower revenue and tax revenues. And, of course, at the end, we have public deficits. So you see, I am trying to explain you that there is a very strong link between the loss of competitiveness in the industry and macroeconomic problems and even public deficit. Now, if we move to the second party, part of this contribution, I will be very short, but perhaps we'll come back during the discussion about the reasons of this industrial decline. And there are some reasons which are frequently evocated in the literature. The first is bad specialization. Bad specialization means a lot of things, but especially price sensibility. If you consider, for example, French exportations are very sensible to the price. It means, for example, that when the euro was it's not anymore, I guess, overestimated, this has a very direct consequence on the exportations, and the exportations are getting, of course, down. So bad specialization is one of the reasons of the industrial decline. For example, the German specialization is price not sensible. Too high cost. Of course, we could have, we'll have perhaps a discussion about the costs. What does it mean, cost? For example, the labor costs, are they too high to have a competitiveness? It is it's a question. Perhaps we'll have a discussion about this point. An overestimation of the euro is one other reason, but I think this reason is today not occurring at all. Two small places of small and medium enterprises. More important, in my opinion, are the bad relations between big enterprises and their suppliers. This is a strong reason for industrial decline. tropism on services and high technologies. If you consider, for example, German industrial sector, it is not specialized on high technologies. It's specialized, for example, in the automotive industry or mechanical industry, even chemical industry. And these industries are not high-tech. If you consider the German exportations, you will find them especially in medium tech and high added value. So you have to differentiate here high technology and high added value. It's not the same at all. And of course, at the end, we should consider too low growth. This point is, again, I think, important because if you consider the big firms, the firms, especially the big ones, they are always looking for new markets. And the new markets are more or less today in Asia. And they invest to get these markets in Asia. But investing in Asia, of course, they invest less in their home country, in their domestic country, and these are, for consequence, low growth in these countries. Now, very shortly, I will stress three less frequently cited reasons, and I will say some words about these three reasons, which are, in my opinion, more important than the reasons I have talked about at the moment. The three reasons less frequently discussed in the literature is the extraversion. I will perhaps explain this word, this concept. And then the financialization of big groups. This is a very important reason for industrial decline. I will talk about this point. And an efficient industrial policy and an outdated conception of work. And these three reasons are not separate. They converge and they work as a system. And this has an important consequence, I think, that there is no simple issue to the industrial and economic crisis. It means there is no way, magic way, for example, to say it would be enough to do that to fight against the industrial decline. If we accept the idea that the industrial decline is a systemic decline with a lot of reasons which converge, these are, for example, absolutely for consequence that we cannot consider that there is just one simple issue to the industrial and economic crisis. So, we'll discuss a bit these three reasons shortly. The first, as I said, is the extraversion and financialization of big groups. And this is the first point which has to be considered is that the fate of big and global firms, groups today, appears not to be anymore linked with that of the national industrial basis. I think this is an important point. If we say French firms, what does it mean, a French firm? If we say a British firm, what does it mean, a British firm? An American firm, what does it mean? It doesn't mean that this firm produces in America or produces in France or produces in Spain or anywhere. These are global firms, and they may be very efficient without having a strong link to their former national industrial basis. I think it's really very important, and this is a topic of the discussion today in America, for example, with Trump and Trump's new policies. Perhaps we'll have a discussion about this point. The overseas investment are more important in the long run than those made in their home country. If you take, for example, the French firms, they invest around 80% outside of France and 20% in France. American firms invest 70% outside of America, 30% inside of America. These are very important data, I think. And the capital structure of these groups are very open to global investors. They are really global firms and not anymore national firms. I think it's an important issue. The second point, very shortly, I have written some articles and books about this point, so it's very short for me here, is an efficient industrial policy. What does it mean? It means that most industrial policies are centered on individual groups. It means if we want to help the French automotive industry, what does the state? The state will help Renault, will help Peugeot or Citroën, but this is not an industrial policy. Why it's not an industrial policy? It's not an industrial policy because industry is not a simple sum of firms. An industry is based on interactions between firms. So if you support industrial firms, you do not support industry as a system. I think this is a very important point. If you want to have an industrial policy, then you have to densify the interactions between firms. You have to have in mind networks between firms and universities, research laboratories, and this could be an industrial policy. But it's not the heart. Today, most industrial policies are centered on industrial firms. Well, of course, there are a lot of things to say about that. And the last point of this reasons of industrial decline is, in my opinion, an outdated conception of work. And together, I would say immediately, an outdated conception of competitiveness. What is competitiveness? And if you say, if you see the mainstream in economics, the labor is considered as a cost. And so we have to reduce the cost to have a higher competitiveness. And labor is not considered as a skill or in generally collective skills are not considered. And I think this is really an obstacle to the implementation of a comprehensive competitiveness strategy centered on innovation. When we say today, when we recognize that a competitive firm has to innovate, then you have to understand that this way to see the firm as an innovative actor is only possible if you recognize that the people working are not only a labor force considered with cost, I mean, of course, wages, but you have to consider people as creative persons working together in order to formalize and solve some problems. If you just see them as as a cost, and you have to reduce this cost, then you will have perhaps a cost and price competitiveness, but you will never have innovative firms. I think this is very important. And the point is to ask ourselves why still today we do have a main representation on innovation, the firms should innovate and so on. But simultaneously, these firms and the main mainstream economics remain by the idea, the perspective that the labor is a cost and has to be reduced. This is absolutely contradictory, and of course we have to get out of this contradiction, but probably the heart of the contradiction is a confusion between competitiveness and rentability. But perhaps we will talk about this point. I think it's a very important point. Well, now to get out of this mess of the industrial decline and economic and social crisis, I think we do need everywhere a pact. A pact is absolutely necessary. And I think that European countries have to, but it's not only true for European countries, I guess, they have to engage a new program, a development program, and in the heart of this program should, in my opinion, be the productive activities. And I will try in some words to design this productive pact. The first point, I think it shouldn't be a surprise if you understood what I said, is we have to find another way to design what is labor. And we have to link this new design of labor with a new design of what is competitiveness. And on one hand, firms have to innovate. And on the other hand, in order to do that, they have to recognize the employee skills. It's very important not to see them as a cost, only as a cost, but to see them as people having experience, being able to solve problems, to formalize new problems. So, in my opinion, a new historical compromise is absolutely needed between companies that choose to focus on innovation and employees who become cognitive. We can, of course, speak about knowledge workers or creative workers. Perhaps you know this literature. That's the first point. A second point, finance must be made to serve more productive activities. Here I would need at least 1 hour to explain this, this slide. It's not the case today. Today it's absolutely on the contrary. It means today that if we try to understand the link between investment and finance, the link is the opposite link that the link was the main link in the 80s. In the 80s, the idea was, I know my investment, I want to do that, I want to invest in this project. And the question was, okay, how is it possible to finance this project? I will use my benefits to do that? I am going to go to my banquier to ask him to ask him a loan. I am going to try to have a public subsidies? And the idea was, I will try to find the best mix between these several possibilities in order to finance my investment. This was the case in the 70s and the 80s. Today, it's absolutely the contrary. Today, I'm not starting from the investment and asking myself how I'm going to finance this investment. Today, I know my rentability. I know that the financial markets are waiting for 15 or 16% return. And according to this norm, I will choose my investments. So you see that the relationship between finance on one hand and investment on the other hand is today absolutely upside down. This is, I think, very, very important. And in order to have another finance, what we absolutely need for industrial development, we have here to introduce what I call temporal retardants in order to make finance again liquid. And today finance is not liquid. Today finance is volatile. It's very, of course, not at all the same to be liquid or volatile for finance. In order to do that, there are a lot of possibilities. One possibility is, of course, taxation. For example, the Tobin tax is here the case. Or voting rights. It's possible to applicate this without changing the rules, the national rules, calculated in proportion to the holding period of the shares. It means that when a shareholder has his share for 2 years or 3 years, it shouldn't have the same voting rights that the one belonging this share for 1 second, for example. A third point is that production should be reoriented to address basic needs. I'm talking about basic needs and not consumption, of course. And this has to be done simultaneously with another perspective. The other perspective is to reduce the burden of productivities on nature. So this both issues are not separate. They have to be considered together. But in order to do that, you absolutely need people working with high experience, high capabilities. And we find again here the very important role of what is work today and how should we consider the work not as a cost but as an innovative factor. Fourth point, the firm, this is here a little bit complicated, I think, to stress that point in 20 seconds, but the idea is, the general idea is that we confuse in almost all countries, perhaps with exception of Germany, the enterprise or the firm on one hand and the society on the other hand. And our right is not based on the enterprise but on the society, on the corporate. It means that the right recognizes the shareholders and not the stakeholders. The stakeholders, in reality, do not have any voice. The only voice in the society is the voice of the shareholders and not of the stakeholders. The French rights, for example, do not recognize the enterprise. The French right knows only the society, the corporate, and it means the persons or the capital holders and not for example, the employees. The employees are considered as they would be outside the firm. And I think this is a very important point, is that the right should institutionalize the enterprise as such, differently to the corporate. So perhaps it's not very clear, and I will come back on this important issue in the discussion. Fifth point, again, here I would need a long time to explain that. I think we should consider in very different way simple location policies and anchoring activities. What the industrial policies mainly do, they play on location. Location, it means if a firm wants to invest, then the industrial actors, the public actors, sorry, will propose land, buildings, infrastructure, grants, equivalents, and so on. But this determinants are very poor. You will perhaps locate a firm, but never anchor a firm in a territory. In order to anchor a firm in a territory, you have to consider that these concerns are not the most important. The most important are other concerns, very short. I think it's important for you to understand this point, is today a firm, a small firm or a big firm, is not in a position to say, we have everything we need inside the firm in order to produce complex goods or services. Today, the ratio added value turnover is around 20%. It means, I'll give you an example, if you consider Airbus, you of course you know the firm Airbus, and you take the biggest plane of Airbus, the A380, the parts produced inside the firm according to the value of the plane is around 20%. It means that 80% of the value is produced by all suppliers of this firm. And the idea to anchor this firm, for example, in Toulouse, is to say, if in the region of Toulouse Airbus finds a sort of ecosystem with all the suppliers, research laboratories, universities, which are needed in order to conceive and produce the plane, then you will, of course, anchor Airbus in Toulouse. The anchoring of Airbus in Toulouse is not because infrastructure there or even land or buildings, this doesn't play any role. The role, the most important, is immaterial, and immaterial is exactly what I've explained. The firm is anchored if it finds the competencies, the complementarity competencies, which are absolutely necessary in order to produce complex good. Of course, trust and confidence are, by anchoring activities, extremely important. Then, I'm finishing the components of this productive part. Social norms are very important. I'm not talking about protectionism, I'm just talking about social norms, economic norms, and of course financial norms. And the question is here, which is the relevant space in order to produce this norm? Are they national? Are they local? Are they international? I think this is an important issue, but perhaps we'll talk about that. And to finish, I'm finishing now, I would like to say that we should perhaps go out of a very diffuse dilemma. Is industry a private good, or is it not a private good when industry doesn't go well? In this case, very often the states are nationalizing the industry. And I think that this dilemma is not a very interesting one today. We should consider industry and not single firms as a common good. And if you consider the industry as a common good, then it means that you have to consider, as I said before, the enterprise as an institution. And this institution cannot be held only by shareholders. You have here to have in mind the stakeholders and the various types of stakeholders. At the end, I think if we think about economic policies, and these economic policies cannot be reduced by just the idea we have to reduce public deficits. This is not really an economic policy. The idea of the economic policies is that they have to run on the long term, long time. And what we need here is really a new development. And the heart of this development, is, in my opinion, the industrial sector. And to finish, I would say that the industrial policies, as I said before, should not support individual firms. But as I said, if you consider that industry is a system, the industrial policies have to increase the density of interactions between productive systems rather than supporting individual firms, of course. And I would like to end. With this perspective, which is, in my opinion, very important, we have to widen the labor democracy. I think our real main competitive advantage is not our technological advance. The real competitive advantage of developed countries is the labor democracy. And this has to be widened and not exactly, on the contrary, reduced. In my opinion, the labor democracy is a sine qua non condition of a strategy focused on innovation. And it means that, of course, you cannot wait for implication of people just by innovating new products and new processes without thinking that these people have to be integrated in participating in strategic decision. Of course, they have to participate also in strategic decisions. Well, this was 30 minutes. I tried.
Hi, everyone. First of all, thank you to the professor for the presentation. It was cut a bit short.
Every time I ask two other people to introduce yourself, including your nationality.
I was getting to it. I was getting to it. I was just going to explain that, even though it was cut a bit short, you did manage to cover some of the things we will mention as well. So we could skip through that maybe, so we will have some more time. This is Haula.
I'm Haula, and I'm from Pakistan.
And I'm Martin. I'm from Norway. So I love your sweater, by the way. Okay. First, a small presentation of what we're gonna introduce. I'll talk about industrial policy in Europe. Mm-hmm. A brief introduction to the recent history. Some of it was already covered. Then my partner will talk about new development model, and we'll have some critics and some questions. And at the end, there's some reference. First of all, there's a decline in European industry. Seemingly, the European industrial policy has been neglected, as pointed out earlier. However, there's been a change, and there's been a recognition that there is a necessity for the overall economy that you have a strong industrial sector. And as will be mentioned later as well, it helps us determine how many jobs we'll be able to have in other sectors. Mm-hmm. Thus, we need a model for development of the industry with some sort of consensus that industrial policies must be at the heart of development. But as we also know, industrialization and deindustrialization is a long process. Mm-hmm. And a complex interplay of different factors. So first of all, an overview of industry in Europe. At the left side, you can see employment and production, where 2010 equals 100. So you can see how there's been an increase in production while there's a drop in employment. And you can also see this sort of slow recovery that then again goes into a new decline after the financial crisis. And on the right-hand side, there's the two blue lines represent the EU, and you can see an overall drop among both the EU 15 and EU 27 as compared to, for example, China, which is the red. So why is this so critical? Well, first of all, as the professor mentioned, their industry accounts for 80% of exports and 80% of the private research and innovation in Europe. So that's one point. The second point is 1/4 of private sector jobs are found in the industrial sector, and additionally, for each job you create in industry, you create between 0.5 or 2 and 2 jobs in other sectors. Mm-hmm. And so on this graph, you can see the manufacturing share of GDP in the EU and how it's been declining and is now around 15% of GDP. The second slide for why it's critical. EU industry has proven more resilient than other sectors when it comes to the economic crisis. It's argued by the Commission that a high density of industrial jobs, to some extent, can help counter economic crisis. And the Commission considers a strong industrial basis as a key element for Europe's recovery from the most recent crisis and for future competitiveness. So first of all, let's look at the issues. Why is the industry declining? So both of these slides are based on the European Commission 2 reports from 2013. So the first point is internal demand in the EU remains weak. And this undermines the home market and intra-EU trade. So this is something that hit during the financial crisis. Simultaneously, we know that one of the most adopted policies from the crisis hit is that you decrease or you cut the real wage of workers, which is a paradox when it comes to this point. On the graph here, I was in the mood for graphs when I made this, but it's interesting because it shows that the intra-EU trade and the trade to the exports to countries outside the EU for all the European countries. And as you can see, there's only 3, soon to be 2, because one of them is United Kingdom, that actually exports more to outside the EU than within the European Union. So a decline in the demand in the European market is, of course, something that would hit all these countries quite hard. And some other points mentioned by the in the report is the overall slow integration to the internal market. Investment in research and innovation that will hamper both competitiveness at the this moment, but also in the future, and higher prices on energy and raw materials, which is something that I think the professor mentioned, and that is something the Commission tend to mention when it comes to these issues. So the Commission's response, sure about that, which is what we kind of compare the industrial policies that will be mentioned by Haula later can kind of be compared to this, because this is the current state. So there is a focus on policies to enhance industrial competitiveness, which is seen to increase the overall competitiveness of the economy. So the first point is to maximize the potential of the internal market by developing necessary infrastructure, offer predictable and stable regulatory framework, and increase training and mobility of citizens. This is something we'll mention again later. And there's the use of instruments for regional development to support innovation skills and entrepreneurship, and a few other points, but I rush a bit through, but we don't have much time. But overall, the goals of the Commission is to increase to raise the contribution of industry to GDP to 20% by 2020, and as we saw earlier, it's approximately 15% at the moment. So a mix of the good stuff. So seemingly, the Commission wants to increase the focus on maximizing the internal market, which has been suggested by several reports that it has a huge potential that's not yet realized. However, with improving the market on the top of the list for a Commission, there are some points to be mentioned. And as I was listening to a couple of old labor movement poets from Sweden when I made this, I had to mention the lack of standardization that leads to social dumping issues related to decreased labor standards in European countries. And this is related to the mobility, so increased mobility, enhancing of the internal market, will also lead to issues related to, for example, unions and system of wage negotiations that have been established over a very, very long time in these different countries. So I'm not saying it's in itself is a bad development. It's just whether or not you're able to standardize and coordinate these aspects. And one last point is the potentially huge, I got Trumpenized on that one, issues that are ignored, such as corporate taxation as well, which is another aspect that is not standardized within the union, that can lead to uncertainty for firms and definitely issues for the specific countries. And real briefly then, just an overview of the corporate taxation. This is not the effective rate, but the statutory rate. But it shows the average here among the EU members, and it shows also there, because we know that they want to enhance the internal market. So here we have the different periods where you enlarged and enhanced the internal market, and you can see how the average among the countries drop. So this is an interesting aspect as well. As long as you don't standardize, how are you gonna have a sustainable development with those policies? So a short summary before moving on. Industrial policies have for a long time been neglected in Europe. The EU have realized the importance of the industrial sector on the performance of the economy overall and for the development of other sectors. The current industrial policies are not complete. They both encourage austerity and neglect specific policy areas related to industrial development, and an alternative model for industrial development is necessary. Thank you.
So before I proceed with the main principles of industrial policy identified in the paper, I would like to briefly reflect on the new and old industrial policy thinking. These views are mainly based on the role of the state. So if we see in case of the minimal role of the state only intervenes to correct for market failures. And if we look at the maximalist role of the state intervenes to shift the resources towards those sectors which will lead to achievement of specific objectives. Whereas the new industrial thinking, here they move away from the dichotomic view of the role of the state and sees industrial policy as a discovery process where the intervention of government, entrepreneurs, and stakeholders, they get together to make strategic decisions. Now, what really appeals to me in this article of industrial urgency is that not only is it based on this new industrial policy, but also constitutes other very important principles. These principles are Sorry for the diagram, it's not so clear, but okay, these are the main principles identified in the paper, and due to shortage of time, and as our professor already explained them, I'll just focus on the main contributions. So what I see as the main contributions, or you can say the essential characteristics of this model, are that it should be the business of the people themselves. That is, labor democracy should be involved in all the strategic decision-making of the firms. Next is, the other essential characteristic of this model is that the profound modification of the productive activities and the how labor is perceived. In this model, what's special and what lies at the heart of the model is the recognition of the labor competency skills, and it sees labor not as a cost, but actually as an essential member of the firm. But however, the issue here is that due to globalization, a product no longer is produced in one location, and many European firms have broken up their value chains and outsourced parts of it to companies located elsewhere. So this is this makes it very difficult to conceive industries as self-contained systems. So here my question is that if firm or an industry is no longer identified as a production unit and an employer at the same time, so this anchoring of activities and creating democracy of a labor force at the workplace, how exactly do we do that? What instruments do we need to make firms see labor as a member rather than just a cost? Moreover, a lot of emphasis has been laid on how we need to reduce the burden of the human activities on the nature and avoid such activities that would lead to ecological disaster. So here, what I see as a main challenge is that how do we ensure this transition without falling into the ecological trap and without losing the jobs? So, and this is what happened in the case of green capitalism, that when they tried to focus on reducing the burden on the nature, they emphasized on hybrid-aided agribusinesses, and which led to the destruction of small farmers, and while they claim that we are feeding the world. Next is the smart specialization, on which the professor will not really agree on. But this concept was introduced in the EU 2020 agenda, and it's based on the idea that instead of spreading the public investment too thinly, why not focus on particular economic activities? This way we can strengthen the competitive advantage and will lead to economic growth. Now, I get here what you mean by the difference between economic growth and development, but I'll like to come to the theory of Hirschman, who says that unbalanced growth does lead to economic development. And that because every developing country do not have the skills, and so it's better that we focus on those which has the competitive advantage, and in the end, it will eventually benefit the society at large. Next, I would like to say that although we might have very good policies, but we're not sure about their success because their efficiency depends upon the accountability and transparency of the policy makers. And ensuring that is not an easy job. And next, I would like to focus on how do we ensure that these policies will be actually implemented by the industries. And what I came across was the reciprocal control mechanism. It is when, in this mechanism, the government sets a target to be met by the firms, and in exchange, they give special favors. And this, according to Alice Amston, has been one of the basic reasons for the success of the rise of the East Asia. Lastly, I would add that although more space and more scope for industrial policy should not be viewed as a simple magic wand, because this is only one of the instruments in an effort to revive ailing European industries and regions. So we need to focus on the bigger picture and need to coordinate this industrial policies with other macroeconomic, competition, and EU-wide policies. And that's it. We'll go to the questions now. So in the definancialization, you focus on the volatility of capital. So I would like to know that how exactly do you reduce this volatility, and does it need to be done on the global level, and how do we deal with its unforeseen effects? Then again, what instruments are required to ensure workplace democracy, and how exactly to change the perception of workers being considered as a cost? And how do you how do we sequence these principles? Like, what exactly do we focus on first, and then will it have unseen effects for the others? Lastly, should we focus on any specific policies to be implemented to fill the gap between the north and south divide of the European countries? And
Yeah, I'll just add one question to that, and it's the question whether or not you can have a centralized a European industrial policy without targeting the economic and social factors such as taxation and labor standards at a that are determined at a national level. And that's it. Thank you.
So you have 2 minutes for answering all these questions.
Okay. So first of all, thank you very much for the time you spent and the attention you spent to in order to prepare your referees and questions. They are very important to me in order to progress myself. Okay. And I will try to give you some answers. But I suggest that we keep on talking by email and articles and things like that. Huh? So at the beginning, you stressed the position of the European Commission about industry and industrial decline and industrial issues. And some parts of the Commission positions, in my opinion, are right. And I do agree with them. And the point to me is that they seem to be blind on some special points. I do agree with the idea that we have to fight against social dumping. But what they do exactly about that? I think they don't really act in this direction, and they even less act in the field of corporate taxation. There is today still a very strong, very hard competition in taxes, corporating. There is still today a sort of dumping in this field, and the Commission doesn't do really a lot to fight against this dumping. You stressed the point, both of you, which is, in my opinion, very important and converge with my own way of thinking, is what is labor exactly? And we have seen everywhere in Europe, but almost in all countries, that the wages are considered as the main factor for competitiveness. And we see everywhere wages are falling. And the question is, why? Are we sure that the price competitiveness is today so important? We may see, for example, that German firms do not really fight trying to have products with low prices. It's very rare to see a German firm arguing by saying, please buy our products because our products are cheaper than other ones. They remain by very high price products because these products are high added value products. But still, it's a sort of paradox that firms everywhere declare that what is important is to be innovative, to have good products according to the demand or according to the needs, and on the same time saying we have to fight against cost, labor cost, and the labor is still, as you write, considered as a cost. This is really a paradox, because it doesn't work. If you go inside a firm and you meet your employees and tell them, you know, you have to innovate, but 10 minutes afterwards you tell them, you are too expensive, I have to short the numbers of employees because the costs are too high. Of course, it's absolutely contradictory. And a firm may only innovate if this firm do not only just use new technologies, but implement people on the workplace and tell them, you have to formalize the new problems, the new products, the new processes, and so on. And the question remains, why the firms still, in the same way as the Commission does, consider the labor as a cost. And I think the only satisfying explanation is not to confuse, as it is the case, competitiveness and rentability. When the firms put the workforce under pressure, the aim is not to perform the competitiveness. The aim is to have a higher return, because these firms are financialized. And it means exactly that the shareholders or the financial markets are putting these firms under a very strong pressure, telling them 7%, 8% of return is not enough. We are waiting for 14, 15, 16, 17% of return. And in order to reach this goal, it means rentability and high dividends and not competitiveness, the only way is to consider the labor as a cost which has to be reduced. And so in the economic discussion, we have to be precise and not to confuse rentability on one hand and competitiveness on the other hand. Of course, I do not consider that a firm should not be rentable. Of course, rentability is necessary. Of course, a firm has to produce returns, but not in any case, and not putting the workforce under pressure. And another question is, what do the firms do with these returns? If the firms would invest in new equipments or in R&D there, I would even say that it's really necessary that they have high benefits and high returns. But if you consider large firms, as I've done in statistic work I have done, and German firms, French firms, and American firms, we see that the high returns they have produced in the last 10 years are in a share of 70% oriented to pay high dividends to the shareholders and not to invest. And here we cannot forget that we are today in a financialized capitalism and not in an industrial capitalism. And here I think that the question related to volatility of capital is very strong linked with what I've just tried to explain. The question you have is how to fight against volatility of capital. In order to give you some elements of response, I think we have to understand that in a global world, we are today in a global world, not in an international but global world, the idea that we deal with two factors It means on the one hand capital and on the other hand labor. This view is too poor. We have to produce a much more precise analysis than the standard analysis, having on one hand capital and on the other hand, labor. To be precise, I think we need to stress the difference between financial capital and productive capital. Financial capital is very quick, is volatile. You can just push on a button and you may transfer billions of euros or dollars in within the second from Frankfurt to Paris or to New York or to Tokyo or anywhere. These are mainly shares or obligations or derivatives. And they flow very quick in a, and the amounts which are flowing are extremely high. But the time period is extreme short. Extreme short, it means a nanosecond, for example. And a bank, to give an example, as the Société Générale in France, produces 80% of its benefits just by calculating the difference of the price of one share, for example, General Electric share, in New York and in Paris. The difference is 1 cent or even less than that. And the computer recognizes the difference, buys 50 million of this share in Paris and sell it immediately in New York. And playing with the difference, the banks is able to produce very high benefits. These processes, which are absolutely financialized, have nothing to do with, for example, direct investments. When a firm makes a direct investment, for example, an American firm makes an direct investment in China or in Pakistan or in Asia, in an Asian country, it takes 2 years, 3 years, sometimes longer than that, to realize this investment. So you see, on one hand, financial capital is volatile. On the other hand, productive capital as direct investment is mobile, but not volatile. So volatility on one hand, mobility on the other hand. If you consider now the labor, we stress the labor as it would be homogeneous, but it's not. It was never the case, but it's today less the case that it was never in the history, long term. Today you have, in some sense, two types of labor force. The people with high skills, with high qualification, with experience, people who are looked for by firms. The firms do need these people. And the mobility of these people is today very high and is getting higher and higher. These people are extremely mobile. Of course, not volatile, it's clear, but they are very mobile. As the investment, as the direct investment are mobile, they are mobile too. The researchers are very mobile. The engineers are very mobile. The managers are very mobile, and so on. The liberal people, architects and doctors and so on, they are very mobile. And then you have 50%, 60%, 70%, I don't know, of the global workforce. These people are not necessarily unqualified. They may be qualified, but their qualification is not the topic of the firms. And instead of looking their mobility, the firms do prefer to transfer the productive capital. I give an example to be clear. If you take the automotive industry, the French automotive industry in the 60s, 50s, 60s, 70s, the French automotive industry needed at that time a lot of labor force, and the French firms, the French managers, went to North Africa and looked everywhere to find people desiring to get more money and able to say, okay, I'll move to France to get a better job and to get better wages. Today it's not the case. Today Renault, Peugeot do not go to North Africa to ask people to move to France. They just move the plants. It's a very, very strong difference. So if you consider the whole picture I'm trying to give you, I hope it's clear, you have four factors and not two. In the former analysis, it was capital, labor. In the today analysis, you have financial capital and productive capital on one hand. On the other hand, you have high skills, high qualified mobile workers, and the other part, 70%, 80%, 50%, I don't know, it depends on the countries. People with less qualification, rather not mobile than mobile. So if you consider the four factors, you see that the question of mobility is very discriminating, because you have on one hand extreme mobile factor, it's the financial capital, and at the other end of the spectrum, you have more or less people who are not moving because their mobility is not encouraged. The government do not want to have them at home. They say, stay where you are and we will move the plants. And this is one main issue of globalization. This is this extreme open spectrum of mobility among these four factors. Is it clear what I've tried to explain? Huh? And then I would like to stress another point is, according to econometric measures I've done with two mathematicians, we can today prove that the income of these four factors is extremely related to their mobility. It means the most mobile factor takes the money and run. Okay? Because if you don't do that and say, here I will have taxation, okay, then because exactly of the dumping we've talked about just before, this financial capital will move and try to have a higher return somewhere else. So the most mobile factor, it means of course the financial capital, is the one who is getting at first its income, 15%, 16%, till 20%. It depends of the domain of the field. And then you have two other factors. The two other factors are the productive factors and the labor force with higher qualification, higher experience, and so on, looked for the firms. And the possibility to negotiate is rather good. It means that these people have an increasing incomes in the last 10 years. But if you sum all of that, the rentability of financial capital, higher incomes for economic investments and for qualified workers to qualify them like that, then these incomes grow quicker than the produit mondial brut, that the world gross product. So it means that the fourth factor, and I mean under the fourth factor, people with less qualification who are not so mobile, support all the prélèvements, c'est difficile. all the incomes which are extracted by the all the other three factors. It is why, the reason why, and in some articles I have written that the globalization is a very unequal process. And the inequality is not a bad side effect of globalization. It is the heart of the globalization. And then is, of course, your question, what can we do against that? And I think, to talk as an economist, the problem is the dispersion, the too high dispersion, c'est ça, the dispersion of the mobility of the four factors. So we have to reduce, on one hand, the mobility of finance capital, and on the other hand, to try to have workers which are more mobile than they are today. How do we reach this very important goal? I'm sorry to answer a little bit long, but I think that my answer covers some of the questions, not only one. To have a lower volatility of capital, it means to have a liquid capital and not volatile. The only way is to introduce measures to put financial capital under a time pressure. Volatility is equivalent with zero time pressure. It means you can move the capital immediately. If we would introduce a Tobin tax, for example, the effect of this Tobin tax would be to cut any interest for high-frequency trading. Do you understand what I mean with high-frequency trading? The high-frequency trading is the trading I've tried to explain when I said that a bank buys today a share and within a second sells this same share just by a very small difference. If you introduce a Tobin tax, 0.0001%, it's enough to destroy any form of this form of trading, which is absolutely parasitaire. Okay, but I think there are a lot of possibilities, and in the book I've published, Industrial Urgency, I have given, I think, around 6 or 7 examples. But one example I've talked about in my very short presentation is the idea that when you gather the shareholders once a year or twice a year or so three times a year to approve the report of the firm. Today, who votes? The voting system is very simple. Is if I have a share, I will have one vote right. If I have two shares, I will have two vote rights, and so on. So the banks, for example, have, of course, a very high rights because they have a lot of shares. My proposal is rather simple. And it is today in discussion by the French group Orange, and it's a telecommunication group. My proposal would be to say, okay, we just link the voting rights with the period of time that the shareholder belongs his share. It means that if you are a volatile owner, you have no voting rights. If you are an owner belonging the share for 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, you might, for example, have four times more rights because you are a stable shareholder. You are a patient capitalist and not a quick capitalism. Okay, so these are two examples, but I could give you all the examples in order to stress the idea that we have to get a liquid capital and not volatile capital. And to finish my very long answer, I'm sorry for that. On the other hand, the only way to have more mobile working force is not to push the working force to move geographically, but to be able to redeploy competencies. It means having qualifications, not specialized qualifications, just being able to work within a sector, but to get a methodological qualifications who give you the possibility to work today in a project and tomorrow in another project and the day after tomorrow again in another project. And I think exactly this is the point which is for me the main point by Hirschman. You mentioned Hirschman. Hirschman is a very fascinating author in my opinion, and he has exactly explained that development is related with tacit knowledge. And the point is not how do we optimize resources, but the point in the books Hirschman wrote is how do we reveal tacit knowledge? How do we reveal tacit knowledge? This point is much more important if you have in mind development than how do we optimize existing factors. To optimize existing factors means that you remain in a way to think how do we have a higher growth. But the question is not how do we manage to have higher growth. The point is how is it possible to have another development? And the question, of course, is not exactly the same. So I could go on, but I think it will be better than stop.
So, yeah, we'll try and leave some time for questions, 15 to 20 minutes at the moment. Yes, so we'll have a wave of short questions. Don't forget to introduce yourself.
So my name is Lilian. I'm from Brazil. And my question is basically, like, you have kind of an agenda for industrialization in Europe. Yeah. And what is the space if Europe pursues a very strong industrial policy for developing countries that really need to industrialize to develop yet? And then would we only be left with cost advantages and how bad actually that is for these countries? D'accord. Thank you.
Second question, please.
Sauf si on n'a pas un, en ce moment je réponds. Hein.
No other question, come on.
For the moment, at least. Okay. Yeah, I'm very pleased for your question, really. I have submitted yesterday a research project on industrialization in Latin America. I will share this project with you if you are interested. I would like to say that Brazil and Mexico are probably in Latin America two countries with an industrial basis. You know that. You have, even if this basis is rather small, but it exists. And the question is for me, why the industrialization of Brazil and Mexico has been
shifted,
yes, yeah. During the 70s and the 80s. Because in the 70s, in the 60s and the 70s, the governments in Brazil and in Mexico had really an industrialization perspective. And the idea was, in the 60s and the 70s, to develop a strong industrial basis in order to give an answer to domestic needs. And the perspective was very clear. It was a perspective of substitution, importation, import substitution. Import substitution means instead importing goods or services from America or Europe, to try to produce these products in the country itself. And this was the case, for example, in the automotive industry or in textile industry, even in chemical industry. And for reasons which are, for me, not very clear, this strategy has been abandoned in the 70s and in the 80s. And if you take the documents of the CEPAL, you know for sure the CEPAL, you see the change of the doctrine in the 70s and the 80s. Instead, keeping on the strategy import substitution, the new strategy is all for the export. And here I think that the pressure of the international institutions, for example, but it's not just an example, the International Monetary Fund, and the pressure of the big North American firms has been extremely high. And I would like to measure that exactly in the statistics, because till the recent years, till 2012, this form of strategy, all for the export, has been a success in some sense. For example, today, Mexico exports more industrial goods to America than it imports industrial goods coming from America. Mexico has an excedent against North America. But if you look carefully, you will see that the so-called Mexican exports are not so-called, are not really Mexican exports. These are firms, of course, coming from North America, which have delocated the production to Mexico. They produce in Mexico and then they export in North America. It's exactly what the Americans call inverse importation. Okay, and I think it's fascinating to try to see now, with a new policy probably of Trump, what's going to be with that. You see, and we would like to analyze that. But if you're interested,
no, it's really wide.
Please.
Yeah. It's just a comment on questions. But I'm Matheus from Brazil.
Yeah.
So it's clear.
There's a strong Brazilian mafia.
Yeah. All this.
Lots of them.
Yeah, please.
So just a comment. To me, it's very clear why I shifted it. It was the coup d'état. So if you take the
just
look at the year 1965, the policies just before,
yeah,
and the policies just after 1965, you have your answer.
No, but you
can't. May
I just add something before I give you the word? Of course, it's very interesting to go out of Latin America, to see the relationship between China and America. It's very interesting. I have tried. You know that America is the only country in the world having an information system, being able to differentiate the gross domestic product and the gross national product. Do you understand the difference between that?
Yeah.
It's really very important. Okay. And today, if you take the both ways, the gross domestic product and the gross national products, you may see that 60% of the Chinese exportations to America, 60% of the Chinese, so-called Chinese, are American exportations. You see? And I guess it's exactly the same for Latin America.
It's just a comment. As you were saying that you were looking for some, why this shift to import substitution to exports, and I think it's very important to look to the debt crisis and the debt crisis of the early 80s, and then you'll see that actually was a real need to find resources to pay, and so it's called the transfer of real resources.
Okay.
And then, well, this is a key explanation for this shift.
I will send you the project, and I'm waiting for your comments.
So please.
And introduce yourself.
Okay,
he's not from Brazil.
I come from Spain.
Yeah.
My name is Dani.
Yeah.
And you were talking about this need for the democratization of the labor market, but for example, there was a reform in Spain a few years ago, and there's been the new loi de travail in France. Don't you think this go against what you're talking we need?
Of course, so exactly, I agree absolutely. It goes exactly on the contrary what I'm what I'm waiting for. Exactly that, yeah. Yes, but yeah, I agree absolutely with that. And the question is, how do we get out of that? It's a very important issue. I agree with that.
Okay. Next question, please.
I will send you a paper I've written. Just a pointer to stress the difference between the dominant way today, neo-taylorism. What we are trying to improve is neo-taylorism. It means taylorism plus new technologies. Okay. And the alternative way I'm trying to push is absolutely in the contrary, is knowledge capitalism. It's something completely different. You see, knowledge capitalism. But the main obstacle to this knowledge capitalism is the financialization. This is the main obstacle. Because knowledge capitalism needs long-time dynamics. It needs investment in education, in professional systems, and so on, in research, in development. This needs time, and the financial capitalism has no time. It's exactly the opposition. Is absolute opposition.
It's something you have in common, probably, with Jean-Louis Beffa, who spoke to them last week.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Next question, please. There's 10 minutes left. Oh, okay. So, Severin, introduce yourself.
Okay. My name is Severin. I'm from Germany.
Yeah.
It's maybe more of a question for clarification. You used the term liquid capital earlier in the presentation.
Yeah.
And I was just wondering if you could expand on how exactly you would define that, because, I mean, liquid is a sort of, liquidity is a sort of a slippery concept, isn't it?
Yeah.
Especially when you try to distinguish it from, I think the term you used was volatile capital,
right.
But then,
right.
I mean, some researchers have argued, like in the Minskian tradition, that, you know, liquidity can itself produce, be a product of volatility and vice versa.
Yeah.
So... Yeah, basically just, you know, what exactly do you mean by liquid capital?
Okay, did you understand before what I said when I tried to say there is an inversion in the link between finance and investment? I think it's extremely important. I will send you again a paper I've coordinated with 6 or 7 other researchers because this inversion is characterizing the financialization of capitalism today. It means it's, in my opinion, very important. We need liquid capital. It means that we need capital to finance the investment. It's absolutely clear that when a firm invests, this firm has to have returns. This firm needs banks. The firms do need the marché financier, financial markets, okay, and these are absolutely necessary. But if you consider today what the firms do with their return, how the banks act and how the financial markets do work, then you will see that they are not financing the real economy. It's exactly the contrary. The real economy is the basis upon what upon which these actors are extracting their income. And this has to be absolutely changed. And the only way to change that is to engage a process of definancialization. And the question is, of course, which are the possibilities? And I've given a partly answer. Introducing time retardants. This is the word in France. But again, I will send you a paper, and and you. But this paper is unfortunately in French.
But they all speak French now. They all have lectures. Okay.
Aber wir können auch Deutsch sprechen, wenn Sie wollen.
Okay. Last but not least. Last but not least. No, nobody. Oh, come on.
Yeah, okay.
So now we go to another continent, actually.
I'm Facundo from Argentina, and you were discussing before the industrialization experience in Latin America and this question that about like why they are aborted. Yeah. And some colleagues pointed out like some like more political reasons. Mm-hmm. But I don't know, I will say also that like besides these political reasons, like all industrialization experiences in Argentina, in Latin America, mm-hmm. Had like inner contradictions and inner problems. If mm-hmm. you see, I don't know, Dilma has the coup, but the coup is not like mm-hmm. happens in a crisis, like mm-hmm. because the economic model was weak. So it's not possible to think that there are also like internal problems of this experience of industrialization that might explain at least partially the failure of these experiences.
Yes. Absolutely, for sure. Okay. For sure. But I would like very much to send you the project and to give me your returns on this project. I'd be very interested. I'm sure you cannot separate economic arguments with political arguments. There are even sociological, I think, arguments which are very important. For example, the medium class, the place, the role of the medium class in Latin America is extremely important, I think.
Well, I agree on that. And also, there's like a field of study that says that the shortcomings from our industrialization process, mainly Brazil, is basically due to the fact that we don't have a national system of innovation.
Right.
So
mm-hmm.
that's also a factor that adds. Mm-hmm.
I agree, probably.
Okay, last but not least, the last question from the last Brazilian.
Hi, my name is Tom. I'm from Brazil too. And I don't want to be repetitive. Maybe you approached this question before, but just to be sure, that when you mentioned that basically entrepreneurs have to see labor not as a source of cost, but as a source of innovation, I always keep wondering to myself, but when you think about industrial policies and industrial economics, what is the role of that person who is operating the machine or the lower stratum of labor in innovating? Because I do understand the concept of innovation and how important it is to capitalist dynamics. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, how this lower stratum of labor can actually innovate, and how important are they to the process of innovation within an institution?
This is a very important question. And I think most people working are innovating, and not only engineers or managers. The question is not so much are the people innovating or able to innovate. The question is how is organized the labor of process of labor. Is it a process, a Tayloristic process with dividing the different parts of the labor process, or is it a cognitive organization. And I think mainly the answer today is Tayloristic or neo-Tayloristic. And we have to move to another way of organizing the process, the production of process. And just to give you a short answer, in order to separate, to try to separate or to distinguish at least, the people who are innovating or not innovating, the question is very simple: is are there these people? Are they confronted to questions which are absolutely new, or are they always acting in the same way, routines, if you want? And if you put this question, I've done that with some colleagues in sociology, you will see that 80% or 90% of the people are in the second category. They are confronted to questions they don't know. They have to formalize the problem in order to resolve them. Okay. And you will find this situation in most industrial processes. So the idea that people do only the same movements is today absolutely wrong. So I think the knowledge workers are everywhere, and not only high-skilled workers, to give you a short answer.
Okay, the very last Brazilian.
All the Brazilians.
Hi, I am Yasmin from Brazil. I found very interesting what you said, and I have a question towards it that is regarding, like, what is the role then of human capital in the industrial process? Because you say that 90% of the people in the industrial process, they just do things like in the same way.
Yeah.
But however, there are many authors, articles in Human Capital that they say that now the companies, they are actually trying to shift to a more knowledge-based society where they can get these skills from the workers. So I don't know, maybe I didn't understand so much, but how can the companies try to shift them towards a more, and try to get more, I don't know, capable.
It's a very complex question. Yeah. Just to give you
in 2 minutes, because it's 43.
Very short and quick element. Today, you have more or less two types of situation. One type is you have to do with people dealing with data and informations, and you have another type of people dealing not with data and information, but dealing with knowledge. This is absolutely different. These are two different worlds. Okay? And the very high danger with big data, for example, is that this big data combined with algorithms may destroy a lot of workplaces. And the only future for not human capital, but for human resources, it's not the same resource and capital, like characteristics are not the same, is to shift towards knowledge and tacit knowledge. If you remain in a world dealing only with information and data, then it's very probable that it will occur a very strong destruction of job places. On the contrary, if you consider people dealing with knowledge and tacit knowledge, combining tacit knowledge in order to solve new problems, then the perspective is absolutely different. And the shift is exactly there. Okay?
Okay. It's 3:45, so you need to go.